Es gibt Kriegsfotografen, die offensichtlich den Horror dessen, was sie so lange gesehen und erlebt haben, den Horror, dem sie entkommen sind, nur dadurch ertragen können, dass sie entweder, das Klischee wäre Vietnam, mit den Soldaten anschließend in dieselben Bordells gehen, in dieselben Bars, denselben Whisky trinken. Es gibt andere, die darüber zynisch geworden sind. Jim ist eine bemerkenswert unzynische Person. Und das ist umso bemerkenswerter für mich, weil die meisten Menschen, die ich kenne, viel weniger Elend und Leid gesehen haben. Einsam deshalb, weil seine Erfahrung ihn selbst von seinen Kollegen trennt und von vielen anderen. Er ist ein anderer geworden durch das, was er 25 Jahre erlebt hat.
The most incomprehensible situation I've ever witnessed was Rwanda, where, I mean, we don't really know how many people died, an estimate of 500,000 to 1,000,000. They were killed with very primitive weapons, clubs and rocks and machetes, face to face. And I saw some massacre sites, and I just do not understand how people can do that to each other. What can inspire such fear and such hatred is beyond my understanding, really. It was very difficult to get over that. When the Hutu army and militia were finally defeated, hundreds of thousands of Hutus fled into nearby Tanzania or Zaire. A cholera epidemic swept through the refugee population in Goma, and tens of thousands of people were being wiped out in short order. It just swept through the camps, and I realized that many of the people I were photographing might have been the very ones who had committed the massacres that I had witnessed just a few weeks before. And it was like taking the express elevator to hell.
Aber während wir entweder über diesen Horror erzählten, um uns darüber klar zu werden, was wir da gesehen hatten, ein wahres Inferno von Leichenbergen, von Sterbenden, von Spuckenden, von unendlich langen Schlangen vor den Sanitätszelten, erzählte Jim so gut wie gar nichts. Jim sagte Hallo, Jim redete ein paar organisatorische Details und Jim sagte, ich gehe schlafen. Und während wir das Bier gebraucht haben, um uns zu erholen von dem, was wir am Tag gesehen hatten, hatte Jim, ich weiß es nicht mehr, ein Mineralwasser oder zwei getrunken, sich früh schlafen gelegt, um am nächsten Tage ganz für sich alleine wieder in aller Frühe loszuziehen. Ich erinnere mich an das allererste Mal, als ich ihm begegnet bin. Seine Haare waren gescheitelt, die Jeans hatten eine Bügelfalte, das Hemd war makellos sauber. In all diesem Staub und diesem Aufruhr stand dieser Mann, den ich vorher nie gesehen hatte, da und machte seine Bilder. Bei weitem nicht so hektisch wie die anderen, in aller Ruhe, als neben ihm der südafrikanische Fotograf Ken Osterbroek erschossen wurde. Hey, man. üblicherweise erwischt es zwei Sorten von Journalisten. Diejenigen, die zum ersten Mal dabei sind und diejenigen, die zu lange dabei sind, weil die nämlich glauben, dass sie bulletproof seien. Und Jim ist in der Gefahr, zu glauben, bulletproof zu sein, einmal zu oft sein Glück versuchen zu wollen. Ich glaube, dass dieser reservierte Mensch, der er ist, den Kick, das Abenteuer, den Adrenalinspiegel und die Todesangst braucht, um sich wirklich lebendig zu fühlen. Dass Jim am besten ist, wenn er am nächsten am Extrem ist. So wie es ja wahnsinnig schwer ist, mit Nachtwey darüber zu reden, welchen irrsinnigen Situationen er bereits entkommen ist. Manche Fotografen, manche Journalisten sind unerträglich, indem sie gar nicht aufhören können zu erzählen über das, was sie alles erlebt haben. Nachtwey muss man das aus der Nase ziehen. Er muss sich bitten lassen, davon zu erzählen. Und auch dann tut er alles dafür, um den Eindruck zu vermeiden, er würde protzen, angeben.
Wenn er zurückkam von einem Auftrag und man ihn am liebsten halt an den Schultern genommen hätte und gesagt hätte, nun erzähl doch und wie war's? Und nein, da mussten erstmal die Bilder entwickelt werden und da mussten die Bilder angeguckt werden. Ich weiß nicht, wo das alles hingepackt wurde oder immer noch hingepackt wird, weil selbst das, was an Bildmaterial vorhanden ist, Fotos, auch das ist ein Minimum dessen, was gesehen, gespürt, gerochen, gehört wurde. Er hat seine eigene Bibliothek des Leidens im Kopf.
I feel as if I've spent at least half of my career working in Africa in one context or another. One of those contexts, certainly the saddest, the most tragic, the most destructive, have been famines. Primarily, these famines were not natural famines. They were a product of war. It's conceivably the oldest weapon of mass extermination known to man. It's very primitive, and yet it's very effective. It's important for readers of publications to understand that most of the pictures they see of famine victims are taken in feeding centers. They're taken in places where food has been sent. We're not taking pictures of people who are starving and not trying to help them. We're not turning our back on them and walking away. It's more difficult to get publications to focus on issues that are more critical. It's never been easy, and I think in the last few years it's gotten more and more difficult as society becomes more obsessed with entertainment and celebrity and fashion. Advertisers are tired of having their products displayed next to images of human tragedy. They feel that it somehow detracts from the saleability of their products.
It was a Sunday, a week after the clashes between the students and the troops. And I got a call from Jim at 10 o'clock Sunday morning saying, there's a problem. There's something going on here. I don't know what it is. There's a church on fire. There's people on the streets with swords, with machetes, you name it. Something is going to go down. As it happened, half an hour later, they had caught three Ambanese men. They had killed them on the spot, with swords and machete, cut them to pieces. And they'd found what they were chasing the fourth one through the streets. Jim was basically with them for the entire chase through the streets. He's got black and white pictures of this guy running with this crazy mob behind him, blood streaming from his head. They were playing with him. They were playing with this guy, torturing like you play with, and little kids play with a puppy. And Jim basically got down on his hands and knees three times, pleading to saying to them, there is no reason for you to kill this man. Just because he is Ambanese, but they didn't listen. They didn't listen to him, and they killed him anyway. But for 20 minutes, he was on his hands and knees praying, saying, please don't kill this man, there is no need. If the situation does get that brutal and that nasty, a lot of people would move away, for their own safety, but I think in a way as an instinctive thing to say, I'm not part of it. Whereas Jim is always always right in the middle of it. He is always part of it. He always has been and he always will be. And his pictures tell that. And I think that's why he was on his hands and knees that day, was because he was right in the middle. I know friends of mine who were there, they weren't next to this guy when he was getting killed. They were standing on a bridge or in a building or just shooting from a distance. And when it becomes up close and personal, that's Jim.